that I wanted to talk about conflict prevention and response in what I think is a new era, basically, in the post-Iraq and Afghanistan era. The good news is there's less conflict and less people dying from conflict now than at any other point in history. The bad news is the types of conflict are incredibly complex. So the spillover into other areas, into other countries, and even the impact on faraway places, which is what you get now when you have a more integrated, globalized world. So a lot of what my bureau worries about is what we call citizen security or civilian security. So you have a very disturbing trend, as you see in some of today's modern conflicts, you have up to 90% of the casualties being non-combatants. The other kind of worrying trend is that our tools, our formulas, the international community, including the US, really have not proven effective at dealing with a lot of the new forms of conflict. Conflicts are not adhering to borders. There's a lot of people power out there. And sometimes it's a positive thing, it's a force for stability, and sometimes it's a negative thing. These types of conflicts where we get very involved are expensive, right? They cost a lot, both in terms of lives and money. We had an unprecedentedly high large footprint in these places. And it doesn't compare to the military when you think about the raw numbers, but for us, for our resources, pretty significant when you're sending 1,000 people every year to Afghanistan. And just as an illustration, this is one of my colleagues down in the lower right. That's a common look for us, right? Body armor just came out of a convoy. In this case, he is working with some Canadian military in Kandahar. And that's a different way of doing diplomacy. There you get a picture of me. I'm with a colleague, a colonel I worked with quite closely down in Kandahar. So if you're in an Afghanistan-Iraq scenario, trying to deal with root causes, very, very difficult. We've got our troops out of Iraq. We're on a trajectory to do the same in Afghanistan. We're in an era, I think, where the U.S. desire, both among the population and the policy from the government, is to kind of come home a bit and to think about how we engage in the world in all the other ways that we do, as much as possible, prevent conflict, but also, when that's not possible, to mitigate it and respond to it. Our bureau has about 160 people. That's everybody, from receptionist to the people who go out in the field. So for us, it's more about, you know, what I'll call here, nation jumpstarting, not nation building. For us, we can deploy people in as little as a few days. We can say, okay, there's a problem in the world. We've got some expertise. We're going to send people to conflict zone X, and they're going to start working the problem at the ground level. Our job is to kind of come in with targeted, strategic, almost like pilot initiatives. Our job is to get there fast, figure out who the best partners are, and start flowing some resources to them to see what works. We know that there is a new way of doing business. The world's changed, so there's got to be some new approaches. That's 21st century diplomacy. See that graph? That's actually just a reminder of kind of the analytical side of things that you can do even before you go to a country. You can gather a lot of information about places from open sources, from various media outlets. You can do interviews with experts, and you can work it into some various modeling and formulas that help you say, well, here are some of the paths things could go down. You know, that graph is just an example looking at some data related to the Arab Spring. Right? You remember when this popped several years ago. And a lot of us at the time kind of said, wow, the spark was this particular individual who lit himself on fire in Tunisia. Well, it turns out there is actually a fair amount of incidents and reporting in the open press that indicated a spike well before that. And we didn't figure this out until afterwards. So as we were standing up, we said, here's an example of some tools that we should be using ahead of time. If you're gonna understand a place, you better understand the whole population. And if you're going to be looking for sources of strength and resilience, the place, the people, the actors, the institutions who are going to help bring peace to a place, don't exclude 50% of the population. So in Honduras, we've been doing some work that's been largely led by women because they have a unique influence in the society. Then the other picture is just pointing out the tech angle. Again, things are changing dramatically. Even in my relatively short time with the State Department, the landscape internationally for technology, mobile technology, is changed. You find cell phones. in places where you don't find roads, you don't find electricity, you don't find running water, you don't find even proper schools or clinics, people have cell phones. And so it is a part of the solution. I think we're just beginning to scratch the surface of how we do that. But we worked in Kenya because in the run-up to their 2013 elections, which were March of 2013, there was a lot of concern that the same thing would happen there that had happened the last time they had national elections, 2007, which was an outbreak of ethnic-based violence. One of the things we did, which is pretty standard in our work, is get to the hotspots, right? So we don't just stay in the capital. So in Kenya, for example, there was two particular parts of the country that had been especially tense in 2007, and we sent our people there, and they lived there, they worked there. Their job was to know the issues there. Burma is an important case because it's a country that's opening up. So it used to be kind of on that list of bad guy regimes, right? You've got your North Koreas, your Irans, et cetera. We helped put together a program that built trust amongst the different ethnic factions, between the local level and the national level, and between the military, which has been the power broker in Burma, and the civilian government, which is trying to stand up now that Burma is trying to enter a new democratic age. Honduras. Honduras has had, for the last several years, the highest homicide rate in the world outside of an active war zone. In certain communities, literally people would wake up every day, walk outside their homes, and walk down the street and find a body every morning. They had a sense that their government couldn't do anything about it. And they built this thing called the Alliance for Peace and Justice. The Alianza, as we call them for short down there. We helped support that group, give it technical capacity building, give them funding so they could do a number of initiatives around the country, like this picture you see there, where they're doing major movements in public to call attention to the issues of violence. In certain neighborhoods where we focused our efforts, we have seen the homicide rate decrease. Now, nationwide, they're still top of the charts. That's going to take a while. But there has been a shift in the narrative. Syria, this is obviously still a very active conflict and a horrible, sad situation because it's not getting better, right? It has gotten steadily worse the last few years. So what we're doing there is trying to help as much as we can in those areas that are not entirely under the thumb of the Assad regime. We're not in Syria. The U.S. Embassy in Syria had to close once the revolution kind of spun up and things got very violent. We evacuated because the embassy could not be protected by the government. So we have been operating out of Turkey. So we noticed inside the opposition areas of Syria, people were starting their own media outlets, underground newspapers, basically pirate radio, you know, kind of pop-up TV stations, because they needed to get information out to the people that wasn't the regime narrative. The state-controlled narrative. And when you get more information, people, they can make better decisions for themselves about how they protect themselves, about how they connect to each other. Because you had a very divided opposition, people who didn't really know each other. They were all working towards the same thing, but they didn't know each other. We've been supporting them, giving them some financing, giving them some training to professionalize the type of media work that they do. Some of you have heard of Joseph Kony and the Lord's Resistance Army. If you hadn't heard of it a couple years ago, you might have caught a big viral video that went around. So the LRA started in Uganda 25 years ago and started out as a rebel group inside Uganda and quickly became infamous for horrible things. Basically, its specialty became attacking innocent civilians and especially kidnapping, abducting children, turning them into child soldiers and using them as part of their army. You see a picture there of a leaflet. So we would create these leaflets which gave people information about how to escape the LRA. You have pictures that depict it because sometimes people don't read. For those who do read, you have it in a number of different languages. You have a photo on the leaflet of people who have escaped the LRA and are now home with their family. These are big figures. These are known people, including former commanders in the LRA who eventually defected and now they're home safe with their families. They've been getting reintegration assistance back in Uganda. And so now we've had people come out of the bush, including Germaine, who literally had a leaflet in her hand, or who come out and say, "I heard the voice in the sky," which was the loudspeaker. That is yet another example of some of the work that we do.